In September 2003, the European Space Agency, ESA, launched their unmanned lunar probe, the SMART-1. 3 years later, it ended its mission by performing a controlled impact on the near side of the Moon. And in doing so, the probe performed a soil analysis.
It did what?
The probe performed a soil analysis.
The probe performed a soil analysis during a controlled impact.
ESA launched their SMART-1 probe to crash into the near side of the Moon and analyze the soil.
Right. First, SMART-1 had no instruments on board to perform a chemical soil analysis. The only equipment that bird carried with her was for lunar exosphere studies, high-frequency radio transmission studies, spacecraft and planetary environment studies, lunar remote sensing, the micro-imager experiment, space laser communication studies, and autonomous navigation studies. Nowhere in this list do you see anything like soil sample analysis. It's not there. Second, even if SMART-1 carried instruments to do soil sample analysis, it wouldn't have had time to do it during the controlled impact. SMART-1 crashed into the Moon at 2 kilometers per second. Now, that's about 4,500 miles per hour. Weighing just under 350 kilograms, 770 pounds, at the time of impact, it collided with enough force to dig a 3 to 10 meter wide, 1 meter deep hole in the Moon's surface. That was the extent of the control. Now, in the half a millisecond it took for SMART-1 to go from being a viable satellite above ground to being an unrecognizable array of metallic fragments spewing out of the hole it dug, it ceased to be a usable satellite. None of the instruments could continue to operate after impact. There wasn't even time for an airbag to deploy. The satellite broke up into thousands upon thousands of itsy-bitsy little tiny pieces that were, in a matter of seconds, scattered over several square miles of lunar surface. SMART-1's own mother wouldn't be able to identify him after that crash. I don't understand how Jared could construe that SMART-1 could have done anything while it was getting ripped apart like that. To do a chemical soil analysis, SMART-1 would have to make a soft landing, collect samples, and do a mineralogical chemical analysis that would take literally hours. But again, there were no instruments on board to do that. I don't know where that lad comes up with this stuff. Jarrah's claim is simply a bare assertion fallacy. And now later, Jarrah offers an Australian Broadcasting Corporation newscast on the SMART-1 impact that makes a little more sense.
By punching a 10-meter hole in the Moon's surface, the probe has uncovered minerals different to the rocks gathered on the surface during moonwalks. The key is the chemical signatures in the dust and debris thrown up by the collision.
Here, it sounds like the announcer is saying that new minerals, plural, were identified in the dust thrown up by the collision by Earth-based observers. Okay. What new minerals were those? They never tell us. Throughout the entire newscast, the teaser is the only portion of the newscast where they mention anything about new minerals being found. The chief mineral that scientists were hoping to find, of course, was ice, under the lunar surface. Why? Because future long-duration manned missions to the Moon will require that astronauts live off the land. And that will require that oxygen and water, hopefully found abundantly in ice crystals just under the lunar surface, be present wherever they land.
The probe has uncovered minerals different to the rocks gathered on the surface during moonwalks.
Knowing that the Apollo rocks are different to those analysed by SMART-1, what proof do we have that men actually went there?
How would the discovery of new minerals on the Moon invalidate the samples that we already have? When William Herschel discovered Uranus in 1781, did that invalidate the rest of the planets that we already knew existed? No. Now, SMART-1 crashed on Sunday, September 3rd, 2006. I'm assuming the newscast that Jarrah shares with us occurred either that evening or the day after. Otherwise, it wouldn't have been news. What I find interesting is that later in the exact same newscast, the announcer says that the analysis of the dust thrown up by SMART-1's crash may not be available for a year.
So each theory of Moon's formation has a prediction for what the Moon should be made out of. And by looking at what the Moon is actually made of, we can eliminate some theories and reinforce others.
It's hoped results will be available within a year. Michael Lockerbie, ABC News, Hobart.
This second statement conflicts with the teaser and seems to be more consistent with reality, since ESA didn't release anything about the crash and the independent observations of the scattered dust before September 7, 2006. And since then, the only thing that ESA has published that mentions any minerals found on the moon are a few articles about the ill-fated Chandrian 1. So why did the ABC announcer say that new minerals, plural, had already been identified in the dust and debris thrown up by SMART-1? And why didn't he name the minerals? This teaser appears to be bits and pieces of information taken from different sources available to ABC at the time. An article published by ABC Online just hours before the crash talks about plans to analyze the chemical signatures found in the flash of light from the impact. The day after the crash, ABC published an article saying that they still hoped that the dust kicked up by the impact would tell them more about the moon. Why would they say that if the results were already in? Incidentally, this article also mentions the 3 to 10 meter wide, 1 meter deep hole that SMART-1 would carve out in the lunar surface. The article also has a link to an April 27, 2004 article about a new lunar mineral, dubbed hapkite, found in a lunar meteorite that fell to Earth in Amman. This is the article that Jarrah should have used if he wanted to build a case for new minerals of lunar origin being discovered that were not already found in the Apollo moon rocks. Of course, how would the scientists know they were looking at a lunar meteorite if they didn't have the Apollo samples to compare to? But there's also a third ABC Online article, a transcript from The World Today, which aired September 4, 2006, the day after the crash, which not only says that the cloud of dust is an ongoing investigation, but includes a statement by Phil Edwards, officer in charge at Narrabri, which puts everything in perspective. He equates trying to fully understand lunar geology based on the limited samples brought back by the Apollo astronauts to trying to fully understand the Earth's geology based on a couple of handfuls of sand from the Sahara Desert. Finding new minerals on the moon, minerals different than those found in the Apollo moon rocks, is something that the scientific community expects to happen. So finding new minerals on the moon does not, in any way, prove or even suggest that the Apollo moon rocks are fake. Jarrah has much more to say about SMART-1, and so do I, but it won't all fit into one video. We will continue our analysis of Jarrah's SMART-1 claims later. Ciao, moon hoax conspirators, wherever you are.